Glad we made it back. We've juggled a few of the schedules, so Mr. Pastor Bill is here this morning somewhere. And he prepared a study for 3 weeks ago, 2 weeks ago. Pastor Bob's off on hunting or fishing or something. He's gone out in the wilderness somewhere, going to find himself. Yeah, so we did get a little bit more progress last week. Wes and I went over to behind the store and we did hang a couple of shade sails, but they're too low, so now we've got to figure out how we're going to get them higher. And I think we've got a plan for that. And then, of course, Buzz over here at the Causeway Cove put this stage up for us. So we're just going to talk about maybe placement next time. But if you want to sit up on the stage and feel special, you're welcome to. Or you can use... seems to work good for the shade. So anyway, let's just, it's been a weird few weeks for me, and I think for you guys too, hasn't it? A lot going on still. I've got a lot of people that are in the hospital and people that have called me for some prayers, and we got a lot of prayer requests on our church prayer team. But there's been some losses in our families, and some illnesses too, so let's just keep them in prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, as we come here this morning, we do come here to worship you. We come here to unite as a family, as a part of your body. Father, whatever part you'd have us to play, we ask you to lead us and guide us in that. We ask you to show us those that are in need, those that you'd have us go to, those that you'd have us care for and meet the needs of. And Father, for those who have lost loved ones, we pray for their comfort, that they might seek you in all things. And that's never easy as well. So today we come, and we come to worship you. We come to praise you, and we come to thank you for you putting your spirit in us that would lead us and guide us in all these things, that we might be righteous on the face of this earth, and that we may know and be assured that we are a part of your family and called to do your will. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. This is Bruce and Janet walking up here now, for those that I mentioned, Bruce and Janet. They're coming behind you, unless you have eyes in the back of your head. But if you'll stick your hand up in the air, I bet if you stick your hand up in the air, Janet will come chat with you. Janet, that's Arlene. Arlene, that's Janet. Go say hello, please. All right, that being said... let's bring, we got some, let's see. I know that, where's Jeannie? All right. I want Jeannie to notice, because the next 2 weeks and the previous 2 weeks I had in the bulletins, that we can always use volunteers at the thrift store. Is everybody paying attention? We can always use volunteers at the thrift store. If you can do 2 hours once a week or 2 hours every other week, if you can give us a regular schedule, we'd love to have you come join us. The spare bodies help us a lot. And we're low on volunteers because of the COVID, number one, but also for a lot of other reasons. But if you can do a two-hour shift, if you can do a four-hour shift, if you can do a whole day, let us know. Go see Jeannie on a Monday when she's in the store, and she will guide you through the training. If you can't do it on Monday, then set a time when you can do it. How about that? And I know I'm alone in the store on Wednesdays from morning till night, so there's nobody in there with me. And what that means isn't that we can't get the customers taken care of. It means that when there's one person in store, they stay at the register, they take care of the customers, and nothing else can get done. So really, if you're good on a cash register, if you're good with placing things on, you know, organizing or whatever, come see us. We could use the help. And that's on the front and the back of your bulletin. Cut it out, stick it on your refrigerator. And if you can find a time slot to help, we sure would appreciate it. So with that said, come on up, gang. Let's play some music. I was looking at this first rig right up here. I thought it was a motorhome hauling a trailer. I thought, man, that's the way to go. All you need is the Harley on the back, and we're all set.
I've lost.
Get out your banjos and your mandolins. That song would say never falter, never fail, and we'd mess it up every time. Just goes to show humans are still humans. I know it's hard to believe I'm human. I have a hard time believing it myself.
Who am I that you are mindful of me? That you hear me when I call? Is it true that you are thinking of me? How you love me? It's amazing.
It's nice to be a friend of God. I had somebody come in and chat with me, and they were saying, well, we're supposed to fear God. You're supposed to fear God, a healthy fear of God. And it's like, listen, I had a kid that used to pick on me all through high school. And I feared him all the time. But when he became my friend, I didn't have to fear him anymore. You don't have to fear God if he's your friend. And if you're doing things together, you know, that's a... Be careful of that. Just, you know, don't pull something out of context. You know, I had somebody telling me he wanted to go do such and such and so to someone who heard him. And I said, yeah, the God says, vengeance is mine. Oh, but wait a minute. Oh, and then, oh, so you have to say, saith the Lord. Yeah, he didn't give it to you. I get it. But he didn't. Vengeance is mine. I'm going to go ahead and get vengeance. And then, no, dude, let it go. Anyway, Pastor Bill and a whole slew of people from over at Alpha have been doing all these online teachings. I'm really thankful for it, too. And I know a lot of you guys are watching them. If you plug in at Reach Church, Reach Community Church Congregation on Facebook, they're always there. You can look up William Lloyd. You can always tell because he has either a hat or a do-rag on. And then John Glenn, of course, has the ones at Alpha Ministries. They're doing one. There's another friend from out there, Tom Benbow, that's doing some teaching out there. If you're interested in doing the Alpha series, I'm sure you could look those up. Are they listed as Chapter 1 or Series 1, 2, 3 for Alpha? So you can search those on Facebook. Look up Alpha Chapter or Series 1 and start there and do 9 or 10 lessons. It's very, 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 very helpful. So, Pastor Bill, if you'll come up and do your thing, I will step aside. And I'm not going to turn it over to you because that thing's pretty heavy.
Good morning, everybody. I appreciate what you were saying, Dave, about the fear of God and punishment and all. Because if you look at, I really do believe, and you know, when you look at the Bible, when you look at the scriptures, I am convinced in my mind, and I could be wrong, I could be, that it is a progressive revelation of God. If you look at the Old Covenant and the contrast to the New Covenant, the contrast is night and day. In fact, in Corinthians, when Paul talks about the New Covenant and the Old Covenant, he talks about that the Old Covenant kills, the Old Covenant brings death. He says the letter of the law kills, but the spirit brings life. If you look at some of the things that happened, and I'm convinced, and if you look at the last, probably as the church, and even John himself matured in Christ, his letter of his epistles in John, those were some of the last things written that we have in the scriptures. He says, perfect love casts out all fear. because fear has to do with punishment. And God's not going to punish us. He's made that clear. And if that's the only reason why we you know, with the threat of, you know, infernalism, then something's wrong with that picture. And God is bigger and more beautiful and true than anything that we know. And we all see through a glass darkly, and we'll all at different levels, not levels, different, we're all on the same road, but some have been walking longer, some get immediate revelations. There's young Christians that I talk to sometimes, they blow me away with the insight and the revelation that they've been given. But we all, Paul says, see through this glass darkly, meaning we're seeking God and we're practicing loving one another. And he's always seeking us out and always inviting us in and always speaking to us, always teaching us. Always. We just have to be aware of it. Ask him, show me, give me ears to hear and eyes to see. This morning, I don't like talking about this subject because it's been so abused in the church. I imagine some of you, how many of you have heard someone say, I don't go to church, all that preacher wants is your money. All they want is your money. I don't go there. All they talk about is money. And unfortunately, that's true in many, many places. And because it's been abused, it's been totally abused. When I was a young Christian, I was in a church, and the preacher was talking, he was talking about Joseph and his, when the brothers threw Joseph and sold Joseph into slavery, and then he became like the Pharaoh's right-hand man, and how the brothers came, there was a famine. If you all know the story of Joseph, his brothers were all in Israel, and they're coming to Egypt, and these are the same brothers that threw him into slavery, and Joseph's brother Benjamin, which was the youngest, and it was the only brother out of all the brothers that wasn't Joseph's half-brothers. So Benjamin's, he's back in Israel. And so when Joseph is talking to the brothers, they don't know who Joseph is, if you know the story. If you don't, go back and read it, and you'll see how much this preacher pulled everything out of context. So he says, so the preacher's preaching, right? And he says, now listen, the brothers came, and Joseph didn't reveal his identity yet. He wanted them to go get Benjamin and bring Benjamin back. And then, when the brothers brought Benjamin and released Benjamin, then they were blessed. They were blessed. Right? So you say, well, that's pretty, that's okay. The next thing this preacher does is he pulls out a $100 bill. And says, who's that on there? That's Benjamin Franklin. Now, if you, church, release the Benjamins, you'll be blessed. Release the Benjamins. Release them now. I mean, anyone with a second grader could see, like, but when you think that preacher has all this spiritual power, you don't question. You say, oh, wow. Yeah, we have to release the Benjamins and be blessed. Give us the money. And you'll be blessed tenfold. Meaning that when they say that, they're saying that if you give me $10, you know, the Lord's going to give you 100. So you would always think, hey, preacher, why don't you give me 1,000 and the Lord will give you 10,000? You know, why don't you give me 10,000 and the Lord will give you 100,000? How about that? If you really believe that. See, there's a, and I snapped it on my phone today. There's this quote. Wayne Jacobson wrote a book, So You Don't Want to Go to Church Anymore. And in that book, there's this quote. Here it is. Priscilla Shire says, in the first century, Palestine Christianity was a community of believers that depended on one another. Then Christianity moved to Greece and became a philosophy. Then it moved to Rome and became an institution. Then it moved to Europe and became a culture. And then it moved to America and became a business. It's kind of scathing to the... When we talk about that, we talk it as the church as a whole, the one that I was just talking to you about. Now, when we talk about the separation of the covenants, the idea of the tithe was an old covenant. It was meant just for Israel. Israel was taught that you're going to set up this system. And what it was they gave 10% of their crops and things to the Levitical priesthood. And then the Leviticus priesthood, they lived off of that, but they also set aside 10%. And then, after so many years, they had this big party where all the stuff that they've been storing, they get together and they party and they eat. That's what the tithe was all about. And somehow the church snuck it back in because it was gone. You don't see it at all in this passage that we're going to read today. Somehow the church snuck it back in. And then they began that you have to tithe. And if you're not tithing, you're robbing God. You know that passage in Malachi that they used, you know, you have robbed God if you're not tithing. It's all nonsense. It's all lies. It's all manipulation. They're taking scripture out of context. If you want to talk to me more about it and go through it, but I'm telling you, okay, it doesn't belong in the church. It doesn't belong under the new covenant. It has nothing to do with the body life of Jesus Christ. Now, with that said, If there's a community of believers to get together and says, hey, we want to set this up and let's set up a tithe, then that's fine. You know what I'm saying? But when new believers are coming into the church and the pastor begins manipulating them to give them their money, and it's right here in the Word of God, and that's bad. That's been harmful to the church, and it has hurt the church. Now, Paul talks about this grace of giving in this passage that we're looking at today in 2 Corinthians. Chapter 8 and 9. And the context of it was there was this famine going on, and some churches, and now in those days, churches were just geographical. You know, you couldn't drive to the causeway, you couldn't drive places. People, wherever their feet could take them, that's where they met. So the community of believers met, and they met in their neighborhoods, in their homes. And of course, you know, that there would be the Church of Fort Pierce, but way down in Miami, maybe there's, you know, and people traveled for days and news traveled. So the famine would hit one area worse than the other. So Paul is kind of the body of Christ is rallying together, and one church that was doing okay was getting a collection together to give to the church that was really hard hit. And that's all we have going on here. But Paul, as he's coaching them and teaching them and organizing all this, he really instructs us on like what's expected in the body of Christ as far as giving, as far as using our money, using our resources to help one another and to further the gospel. So the first thing that we see at the top of your outline is that it's not a law, and I just talked about it. It's not only money either. You can give of yourself, your very being. God wants, He wants our lives. He wants our lives in His family. See, He's made us His children. He's made us, we are adopted into the same sonship that Jesus Christ was adopted. Jesus Christ, this whole mystery of the incarnation of Him becoming man. In Acts chapter 13, when they're preaching on the resurrection, it was on that day that God said, now I have adopted you to the Son. Wait a minute, they've always been Father and Son. But today, that day, He was bringing the humanity of Jesus Christ into the heavenly kingdom, the throne. Jesus sits on the throne. The Son of Man sits on the throne. It's mind-boggling. But God has done this. But we have been adopted the same way by God. He's adopted all humanity as sons and daughters. Family. He's talking about family. We're his family. So he wants us first and foremost. Now, while we're here, walking out in this sin-cursed land, in this sin-cursed bodies, right? How do we walk out loving one another? How do we walk out the gospel? How do we walk out giving one another? And he's made us interdependent. So it's not a law. Paul says, I am not commanding you. Excuse me. But I want to test the sincerity of your love by comparing with the earnestness of others. For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Though he was rich, yet for your sake he became poor, so that through his poverty we might become rich. Not only talking about money there. Jesus is talking about, Paul's talking about the fact that Jesus became human. He came and he bore our sins in his body on the tree and he changed us in that. See, it wasn't that God was so angry. That old theory of like God's so angry and he just wants to get us. But Jesus came and, you know, changed God's mind. God never changed. We needed to be changed. We needed to be made a new creation. We, Adam and Eve ran from God. We felt shame. And God came and sent Christ to change us. Not to change God's mind about us, but to change us. He became sin so that in him, the scriptures say, we might become the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. And Paul saying, follow this practical example. You're not going to do what Jesus did. Only Jesus did that. He's the one and only Son. But you can practice and imitate that by giving and loving one another through gifts. And here in this case, it was money or food or whatever was needed. The other thing here is he tells them, pay your bills first. This is so important. I've been in churches where the preacher has the people getting out their credit card and going into debt for the building fund, and that God will pay you back, and God will reward your faithfulness. It's all nonsense. And I've been in Bible study groups where people have questioned this and say, well, you know, my church says that, you know, even though, you know, I'm in debt, I should still give, because then God, no. Pay your bills first. Look what he says. Our desire is not that others might be relieved while you are hard-pressed, but there might be equality. Motivation matters, not amount. 2 Corinthians 9:7. He says, each of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. Okay, God wants us to do it cheerfully and unto him. And if we have fears or we have insecurities, he's going to work through it. He's patient with us. Okay, how many of you would give money to somebody you don't trust? You give money to someone you don't trust? You know, they call you, they tell you they have a deal of a lifetime, a slick salesman. Yeah, after you get burned a few times, then you don't trust people. Okay, we don't trust people we don't know. See, God's main desire is that we know him. And once we know him, we hold light more lightly. But if we're unsure, we're not convinced God loves us unconditionally, that he has our back, we're not going to give cheerfully. And that's okay, because I've been there. I responded to the message of, oh, God loves me unconditionally. This is great. You know, Jesus died for me. There's eternal life beyond this. This is great. And then I went to church. And then I wasn't so sure God liked me. Wasn't so sure, you know, oh, really? Oh, man. Acts 8:12. For the willingness is there, the gift is acceptable according to what one has. Not according to what one does not have. Pay your bills first. Buy your wife some roses first. It's all about community and body life. See, this is the thing. What Paul is talking about and what I really believe God wants to work in is this is about community. This is about one another. This is about loving one another. Well, we pray for one another. We support one another. We uphold one another. But if we know that someone is without and we can do something about it, and it doesn't have to be something so big. There was a friend of mine, he said I just had all this guilt, you know, and it was just his nature. He says, you know, the people starving in other countries that I never see, it's all my fault anyway. It's my fault. I'm responsible. I should be doing something about it. And then he realized that, you know, he doesn't really have any control there. What can he control? And he noticed that on this one route he used to take, there was always a guy there with a sign on at the light, you know, wanting, please, whatever you have, please give me money. Now, we that are around recovery and know the pains and the how low people can go in addiction know that a lot of people that are begging for money, there's a good chance that they're an addict. They're an alcoholic. They're a drug addict. Not everybody, but there's something going on. So you're hesitant to give them money, because you know that they're going to go buy and use. And that's happened over and over. I've seen it. So this guy said, well, I just never know. But I don't like just ignoring them. They're people. They're God's children. We all have the imago Deo, the image of God. So what he did is he would always carry this little lunchbox with him with granola bars and other stuff. So that when that situation did occur, he'd say, here, ask the person his name, give him a few things, and feed them. Right? I would say to somebody, I'd been asked a lot of times in parking lots and things, and when we were at the Whitestone Church, they would panhandle. I'd say, listen, and I'd be real blunt sometimes. I'd say, I'm not going to give you any money, but I can get you help right now for your drinking problem or your drug problem. I don't have that. And once I talked to them more, they did. Or I'd say, let's go over to the store over there. I'll buy you something to eat. If you're hesitant to give people money because you're afraid you're enabling their habit. So that was just one. He says, I realized I could do little things in giving. Nothing big. I can't solve the famines or I can't starvation in other parts of the world. But in our little part of the world, doesn't have to be do great things for God. How about little things for God every day? Okay, it's community. We're all part of community. We're all responsible to one another in that sense. Because look what Paul says here. He says, as for Titus, he is my partner and co-worker among you. As for our brothers, they are representatives of the churches and in honor to Christ. Therefore, show these men the proof of your love and the reason for our pride so that the churches can see it. So he's talking about the inner dynamic, the fellowship that's going on between the believers. Okay, and when he says that he's his partner and co-worker, these are deep, abiding relationships that people have for one another. Okay. And I took step 12 here because it's essential to recovery. It's essential to the big book. It says having a spiritual awakening, right? We've carried the message to other people. See, if you're in recovery, you don't stop at 11, right? We don't stop at step 11 and say, you know, this is great. I'm really increasing my contact with God and my awareness of God, and I just love hanging out with Jesus. It's so good. This is great. Step 11. I want to stay right there. But it says, having a spiritual awakening as a result of these steps, we tried to carry the message to alcoholics and to practice these principles in all our affairs. See, giving back is so important to recovery. And we're all in recovery from something. Giving back and contributing and being part of something is so essential to our recovery. I remember when years ago there was a program that came in through the government. It was called Access to Recovery, And basically what happened was the people really studying drug and alcohol addiction, they really saw that when there was really a strong faith-based component to the recovery model, that the success rate of people getting sober, staying sober, and living healthy in recovery was higher than non-faith-based, without God. And that was from the beginning, the 12 steps. I mean, there's so-called secular organizations that use the 12 steps, and they missed it altogether. So what the government did is they said, we're going to give money for recovery to these faith-based institutions. And they asked John Glenn to come, and they said, we just don't want any, no one can just come and say, hey, give us money, we want to work with addicts. That never worked with addicts before. They had to go through the training, the Journey to Freedom curriculum. And the drug czar, I forget what his name was, but we were at a meeting, and there was a man, he's since passed away, Bernie DeCastro, who did a lot of work around here. And there was a group, actually they were a group of ex-bank robbers, and they all had drinking problems, that had a ministry, Time for Freedom Ministries, up in the Ocala area. So there were a bunch, and they were all these men were former addicts. And the drug czar said to John, I don't understand, you know, like what's the missing ingredient? You know, we have all these rehabs, people go through rehabs, and the relapse rate is just over and over again. They don't get better. What's the problem? And he said, all these men here that are here trying to figure out how to help people, he says, they're all in recovery. That's what recovery looks like. Loving and helping others. Loving and giving back to others. That's where it all comes alive. That's where it all comes together. You can't stop at step 11. He says, all these men, he says, they're not just here because, you know, they're part of the ministry or anything. They are former drug addicts and alcoholics. Go talk to them. They're giving back. They're carrying the message. So it's so important, because if we live in the new creation of who we are, okay, we don't, like, the best defense, right, is a good offense. So if our motivation is to love other people, okay, we don't have to worry about all the other things that we get so worried about, that Dave just kind of mentioned about punishment or having a healthy fear of God. There's no reason to fear him if we're in union with him and we're in that yoke with Jesus and we're seeking how to love other people. Okay? Seeking how to give and love to other people. Because it gets us outside of ourselves, and because the Holy Spirit lives in us and is producing that fruit, we're looking outward. We're God's eyes, God's heart, God's Spirit is living with us and in us, and we're looking outward with Him, with God. Because He's given us eyes to see. He's producing faith. His Spirit is welling up in us. The Holy Spirit living in us and through us isn't some thing that's just nice to talk about. It's a reality. Okay? We're that union, that personal thing that you have. And God's very personal, but He's also very, very, very much about community. Living in community together, where we give and live and argue with one another and love one another and give to one another and help one another out. It's all about that. But the giving comes from within, from the heart, not from without, not manipulation. Okay, and it's very personal between you and God. Very personal. And you know what? You'll know the fruits of it when you're kind of excited. You and God are excited together about what just occurred, and the love and the giving and the transaction. Because God's excited. You know, he's very excited. There was I'm going to end with this, that Jesus said two things. Jesus said that if you give a cup of water to someone in my name, he said, you'll not lose your reward. Meaning anything we do motivated by love, something as little as that here, I love you. You won't lose your reward in heaven? That means all of heaven's excited about that one little gesture of love. There was a atheist professor, and he died, and he was in the in between. He called out to God from whatever he remembered, and Jesus came to him, and he had this experience. He had this encounter, and it seems like all the people that that happens to, there's some kind of life review that happens, where they're meant to see how much their life matters. It's not a life review like, look what you did. It's showing how much your life matters to other people. And as this review was going on, this atheist professor said, wait, stop. You skipped over the most important part of my life. I was recognized, and I was on some big, you know, who's who list, and they had a banquet in his honor, and he had this big prestigious reward. And he said he could almost feel like Jesus was chuckling, and like that really doesn't matter. That doesn't matter. And he says, I'll show you what matters. And there was this other scene where he was a teenager, and his younger sister, much younger than him, had some kind of nightmare, and she was afraid, and he went in and was talking to his sister and loving her and comforting her and holding her hand. And he said he felt like, yeah, that's really what it's all about, what makes God happy, is that love, because God is love. And whenever that's going on, the love we have for one another, it's exciting. It's good. So if you give a cup of water or a granola bar out the window to somebody, anything, God's saying, this is beautiful. This is good. This is what it's all about. Just giving of yourselves. Not with what you don't have, but what you do have. You ever find yourself, well, if I win the lottery, then I'll give all this money. But we're not winning the lottery, folks. We're not. It's not going to happen. I tried it. Right? It's not going to happen. It's not. Paul said, don't give what you don't have. What do you have? Share that. Amen? Amen.
Thank you. Can I have your hat?
Yeah.
No. Just asking you to give me what you have. If you give me one hat, God will make sure you have 10 more. That's the good news. Amen. Hallelujah. Interesting. When I was going over this, I was reminded of when I first got saved and I first started going to church. I was doing all the math, and because being that I had a sign business, you know, my income changed every week depending on if I had three jobs or zero jobs or one job. And at the end of the week, I would add up what I had, and I'm supposed to give 10%. And it's is it before taxes? Is it after taxes? I've got to be sure I'm giving 10%. And I was struggling with it because I thought that's what, you know, when you live by what you're supposed to do, you're supposed to do this and you can't do that and you have to do this and you should do that and you shouldn't do this. And it had me stressed, and I finally went to the pastor. Actually, he became my senior pastor, and he actually is the one that ordained me into this. And now it's the Crossing. Back then it was New Hope. Now it's the Crossing New Hope. Imagine that, huh? Anyway, I kept going back to him, and he said, listen, don't stress about it. On the day when you're ready to give, he says, you do what God tells you to do in your heart. And I was like, okay. So sometimes I open my wallet and there's no money there. So you can't give what you don't have, right? Like Bill said. And sometimes there was money there, and sometimes God would tell me put X amount in, and I'd just do what God started telling me to. And what I found out is at the end of the year, when I did my taxes and they gave me a tithing report, it was well over 10%. I never stressed about it again. It was like, whatever. Just give as God leads. It came with great joy. It was a relief, actually, to not stress over it. And the numbers were no concern. It was amazing. And it's not always money. Maybe you're giving of your knowledge. Maybe you're giving of your time. Maybe you're giving of your heart. You might just be given, you know, a little piece of advice to somebody that it might change their life forever. How many people don't like to give advice because every time I do, they don't listen anyway. Right? But we're called to plant a seed. Sometimes we have confrontations in our life and we don't like to hear it, but maybe it's to get you to think. So giving in grace, or a grace of giving, is doing as you're led by the Spirit. And is not a law. Matter of fact, I always go to the one that's in Deuteronomy, and people kind of look at me sideways, but John Glenn taught me about it. It says if you're not near the temple and you've saved up your tithe, spend it on whatever pleases your soul. And then it goes on. It says, if you want sheep, buy sheep. If you want cattle, buy cattle. If you want strong drink, buy strong drink. What we're talking about. And when you partake of such, you give thanks unto God. Remember where it comes from. Remember that this is God. So, and the other thing that I learned about the tithe is there were 12 tribes. One was the ministering tribe. And the other 10 tribes would give their tithe to support the ministering tribe. So, you know, that's us. I'm the ministering tribe. He's a ministering tribe. However, the Levites, was it the Levites, right? They weren't allowed to own cattle and property and Maseratis and jets. Oh, did I say that out loud? They didn't own anything. They were being supported by the other believers. So we've got it really rather confused when you give to me so I can build a mansion on the hill and get my Maserati. You need to give to me so I can have my plumbing fixed instead. I'm kidding. That's been really fun, by the way. And I haven't left you out of the loop on purpose. I've just been crazy with it. We'll talk. Parks was so helpful to come over and try and help me with the situation. And then there's a lot going on at house. We have water. That's a blessing. It's not like I like it, but we have water. Pay your bills first. Sometimes I see people who are living beyond their means, struggling every day. What I've discovered about people is that I've met some very, very extremely wealthy people who are some of the nicest people I've ever met in the world. They're down to earth, they're pleasant, they're casual. I've met people who want you to think they're very wealthy and they're miserable, trying to keep up with everything. Chasing the next penny to pay for the next toy, to pay for the next this, that, and the other. And they want you to believe that they're all that when they're struggling just as hard as you and I are. And it's hard to watch that, but it's what happens. What is your motive behind giving? Are you giving because you have to? Because you're supposed to? It's supposed to be this amount? And if I don't give, then God's going to get me? Because that's not a good motive at all. It's not even about the amount. It's about what's going on in here. Why are you giving? It's all about community and body. Sometimes I get caught up with, I wish I could help others more, but then I have this little part of me that I came out of being a severe codependent, where I tried to fix everybody all the time. And I had to get to the point where sometimes it's not my job. I can't do it all. I can't change the world except for one person at a time. So you can change one person at a time. And being a part of this giving community is essential to recovery. And when we talk about recovery, I know we go a lot towards alcohol and drugs, but I prefer to think that we're all in recovery from this, the flesh. Our selfishness, our egocentric desire to have importance, to feel good, to look like a good person. I'm going to give so everybody sees me and stand on the grandstand. And, you know, that's not an effective way of finding joy and peace, I promise you. Because it'll leave you flat. A lot of people I know that give totally and completely anonymously. And then there's some people who have their family name on the Forbes 500. Maybe not necessarily because they wanted it there. Maybe because they're such pleasant and good givers that they just, that's the earthly reward. And it may be the only reward. But a lot of the people I see on the Forbes 500, a couple of families that I know personally were really strong people of faith. It's amazing. my wife and I went on a marriage encounter weekend, and then we sponsored a couple other couples on marriage encounter. And what we found out at the end of our weekend was we were sponsored by the people who owned the hotel. Everybody on that marriage encounter weekend was sponsored by the people who own the hotel. They have a place in Chile. They're mega millionaires. They have hotels all over the world, and they want to change people's lives and fix marriages. It was an amazing thing. And they showed up to meet us. That's the kind of people that those people were. So it's amazing. Let's do the time out for the trip in. Do I have a sense of I am supposed to in my giving? Do I give because I'm giving back? Sometimes we give back because we feel like we owe something. But don't you remember that this gift of the Spirit was a free gift? Well, I'm going to give back to Jesus. But it was a free gift. What if you just give freely, like he did, without expectation? Matter of fact, the Bible says that Jesus gave his life so that all men, here's the key word, might become a friend of God. Might. I'll give just maybe it'll save people. I mean, Jesus knew and he was God, but he gave his life so that we might be saved. That leaves a lot of options open, doesn't it? And how do you feel if you miss a week of giving in the above manner, where you're doing it out of a sense of guilt? Oh my goodness, I better go make sure I give double next week. I better be sure it gets there. I don't know what the motive is, but only you do. What happens in your guilt feelings? Jesus came to remove guilt and shame. I always like to go there. Jesus came to remove guilt and shame. So why are you feeling so guilty? Why do you feel ashamed of yourself? Well, I can't ever get it right. Yeah, God knew that. That's why we need Jesus. But I keep messing up. I understand. You know, there's tons and tons and tons of Christians who struggle with addiction. Doesn't mean they're not saved. It means they're struggling with an addiction. It's a physical problem, or maybe an emotional problem, or maybe an addiction problem. And they don't know how to get out of it. What do you say? It's because your faith is weak. Not necessarily. Maybe your flesh is weak. Maybe you don't feel like you're part of something. A lot of people I see in that go church to church to church to church to church to church to church. As a matter of fact, I talked to a guy this week. You ought to pick one and get on one message. Because I'm not sure what every other church is teaching. But get on one message and try and get some clarity on it. Understand you want to get more God. I get that. But what if they're all... I remember listening to WCNO years ago, and every 15 minutes was a different pastor, and it seemed like by the end of the day, I heard 7 different opinions of one verse, and it confused me. So I prayed about it, and God said, hey, here's an idea. Why don't you read my word and listen to me? Hey, what a thought. I started reading his word and listening to him. I shut off the radio, because I don't need confusion. Who's the master of confusion? It ain't God. The only thing that Satan has for us is confusion about two things: who you are and whose you are. And if you're a child of God, then he ain't got nothing in your life. Don't give him any credit. There's no strength there. So, simple little prayer. Father, help me to understand that you understand my money matters. And show me how you wish me to give. As the opportunities arise, I trust you in all matters. Do you trust God in all matters? Yeah, except for that one. It's my biggest prayer, like Jesus prayed, that we might know that we're one with Jesus, that with Jesus, we're one with the Father. We're in unity with God. We're friends, we're family. That you have the Spirit placed in you to lead you and guide you. And the best thing that you can do to seek righteousness is to listen and trust the Spirit he put in you. Heavenly Father, that's my prayer this morning, that each one within the sound of these words would trust you and your Spirit within to lead them and guide them, that they might find the fruits of the Spirit, which are peace, patience, kindness, gentleness, mercy, self-control. Yes, I'm finally remembering that one for myself. Father, that's my prayer this morning. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. A couple more songs on the way out. Every time I pick this song on the playlist, There's only one, well, there's two people that come to mind, God, but Beverly. Bev comes to mind because she's like, I hope you play my song. She usually does it right after I've done the playlist. But this one happened because God intended it to be today and for her to be here. Hey. Oh, we have a new praise team leader. Want to welcome Wes Taylor. Wes Taylor. That's good. Wes Davis. Oh, she's waving. That's usually what I announce. So Mara Starris is over there with communion. Oh, by the way, I want to welcome a lot of people back. Lars Niels. Niels is back from his journey. We have our family from Maryland back. Thanks for coming. They traveled 16 hours just to get here this morning on time. A week ago. And I'm glad to have everybody back, actually, but I just wanted to say thanks. And the Robinsons back there.
Oh, Robinson.
The switched family Robinsons.
Hi, Miss Robinson.
Here's to you, Mrs. Robinson.
Coo-coo-ca-choo. Get up and dance, Bev.
Look what the Lord has done. Look what the Lord has done. He healed my body, he touched my mind, he saved me just in time. I'm gonna praise his name, cause he's changed just the same. Come on and praise him, come on and praise him. Look what the Lord has done.
On the line.
Look what the Lord has done.
Anybody, somebody.
Look what the Lord has done. He healed my body. He touched my mind. He saved me in just in time. I'm gonna praise his name. He said he's just the same. Come on and praise him. Look what the Lord has done.
Going up.
And look what the Lord has done. Look what the Lord has done. He healed my body. He touched my mind. He's just the same. Come on and praise him. Come on and praise him. Look what the Lord has done. Look what the Lord has done. Look what the Lord has done. He healed my body. He touched my mind. He saved me just in time. I'm gonna praise his name. And each day he's just the same.
He healed my body.
He touched your mind.
He did save me.
A little reggae music for the going out.
It's before too late.
Children crying, hear the children crying.
dirty remarks. There is one question I'd really love to ask. Is there a place for the hopeless sinner who has hurt all mankind just to save his own belief? Singing one love, talk about one heart. To fight this holy Armageddon. So when a man comes, there will be no doom. Have pity on those whose chances seem thinner. There ain't no hiding place from the Father of creation. Singing one love. What about the one heart? Have a great Sunday, guys. Just want to remind you, my friend Charlene at the Coyote Grill, she is open on weekends now. So you're welcome there to have breakfast. I think they're only there till noon, so it's always good breakfast at Charlene's Coyote Grill at the RV park out there, Roadrunner. And God bless you. Have a safe and wonderful, prosperous week.